Hey Leute, willkommen zurück zu Let's Play The Great Ace Attorney Chronicles. Im letzten Part haben wir uns hier im Bonusbereich das Auditorium angesehen, oder eher angehört, all die schönen Musikstücke und Soundeffekte aus dem Spiel, mit ein paar interessanten Bemerkungen noch von den Komponisten. Und jetzt werden wir uns in diesem Part die Galerie angucken, diesmal auch wirklich angucken, nicht anhören. Und da dürfte es auch wieder ein paar, steht auch hier schon, ein paar Bemerkungen geben von den Entwicklern, von den Künstlern, die die ganzen Charaktere und Szenarien gezeichnet haben hier im Spiel. Und auch Concept Art dürfte es auch geben, ziemlich cool. Deswegen, das werden wir uns hier in diesem Part angucken. Erstmal die Porträts. Da haben wir verschiedene Charaktere, Ryunosuke, Susato und so weiter. Die ersten beiden habe ich schon ganz kurz mal angeklickt, weil es wirkt so, als gäbe es hier nur die Bilder. Aber nee, es gibt auch noch Texte dazu. Nämlich hier, von den Zeichnern eben. Hello, I'm Kazuya Nuri oder so. Art Director and Character Designer for the game. Let me show you some of the character design and scene setting artwork produced during the development of the Great Ace Attorney Adventures. Here's the hero of the whole show, Ryunosuke Naruhodo. The main concern here was to strike a good balance between a period look of someone out of Mage Japan and a believable ancestor of the protagonist of the main Ace Attorney games, Phoenix Wright. Ja, haben sie auch gut getroffen, finde ich. Passt ziemlich gut. So, das hier ist das vollständige Bild. Wunderschön. I started off with a stoic university student uniform befitting the period, but I didn't want it to be too generic. So I altered the cut of the back and the sleeves and added some details to suit the Japan in the world of the Great Ace Attorney. The buttons on the back accentuate and draw the jacket in to create smart, swelled lines. Wunderschön. Ich meine, so oft sieht man ja Ryunosuke von hinten gar nicht mal, dass da so viel Mühe sich gegeben wurde für die Hinterseite, die man eigentlich nie sieht. So ungefähr ist krass. The picture was drawn as a reference for Ryunosuke's principle in court camera angle. He has his sword drawn because, well, I just wanted to see what it would look like. Ziemlich cool. This is Ryunosuke's traveling to Britain outfit. I included the school cap and cape as they lend an obvious period air, being so different to modern clothing. These sketches are from the very first proposals. Oh, die Frisur von Phoenix. No scenarios had been written at the time, so I had Ryunosuke younger than he ended up, and his hairstyle was based more heavily on his descendants than on something faithful to the periods. Wäre irgendwie auch lustig gewesen, finde ich, wenn er schon eine Phoenix-Frisur gehabt hätte. Also es passt natürlich auch so, wie es ist, mit seiner Frisur. Hätte ich sogar vielleicht so aber witziger gefunden. Egal. Male hairstyles during the period Meiji Japan were nowhere near as diverse as they are today. They were either cropped short, side-parted or swept back. Ziemlich coole verschiedene Frisuren, die Ryunosuke da hat. Ich finde, die passt ihm, die steht auch ihm, finde ich. Die da, die am ehesten wie von Phoenix aussieht. Ich finde, das hätte auch gepasst. I wrestled with various options to create something that was realistic and faithful to the period and to Ryunosuke's personality, while still being suggestive of his descendants' manga-style hair. I remember drawing these sketches as a way to distract myself when I was stuck on the hairstyle. It turns out they came in useful for explaining how the game works in the game proposal documents. Auch ziemlich schick. Whilst the overall character design is reasonably uncomplicated, I was conscious that I wanted to convey the unique qualities of this game's world by paying extra attention to the fine details. Schwert und Armband natürlich und auch Pin. Every accessory and adornment has personal significance to the character, which is an idea I hope players will use their imaginations to explore. Dann Susato. Jetzt geht's weiter mit ihr. Hello, I'm Kazuya Nuri, Art Director and Character Designer for the game. Let me show you some of the character design and scene, bla bla, Adventures kennt ihr schon. This is the female lead, Susato Mikotoba. Da ist sie. Wunderschön. The theme for the design was that of a female student who embodied the principles of Yamato Nadeshiko, or a personification of the quintessential Japanese woman. So I decided to use the easily identifiable and typically Japanese cherry blossom as the Mikotoba family crest, influencing the pattern of her kimono and hem of the Hakama trousers. The heart of Susato's character is her impeccable upbringing, which I've tried to bring out in various elements of her design, from her posture, facial expressions and the quality of her kimono. Ist auch gut gelungen, finde ich, das Design von Susato. I designed Susato's wrap to complement Ryunosuke's traveling clothes. Knowing it would only appear in an anime cutscene, I decided to keep the design overwhelmingly simple with the exception of the clasp. I wanted Susato's hair to be styled appropriately for the period, whilst at the same time being a little out of the ordinary. I ended up with something that looks relatively simple in silhouette, but is actually quite complicated. Das glaube ich. Ich finde es auch sehr kompliziert, wie ihr Haar funktioniert. Ich weiß nicht, ob ich das so binden könnte. Das meint man gar nicht, aber ich glaube, das ist ziemlich kompliziert. Das muss man ja da so hinten wieder reinstecken quasi. Und dann hinten hat sie ja nochmal einen Extra-Zopf, der eigen ist. Also ist kompliziert, glaube ich. Das war alle der Text hier, ne? Hier. This frontal portrait was drawn while the kimono pattern was being finalized. I tried a great many different designs before arriving at the final one, in order to find a pattern that didn't draw excessive attention. Dann hier, das ist auch süß. This is an early proposal sketch, when it wasn't yet clear how folksy to make Susato. Later, in parallel with Mr. Takumi's scenario development, I got a better feel for her character and softened her into a refined young lady. Mhm. Ich finde, sie passt besser so, wie sie ist. Aber das wäre auch ganz in Ordnung. Dann, this image was drawn to help with the anime creation. Anime cutscenes form bridges between various scenarios in the game, so it's vitally important to avoid any discrepancy between the renderings of the characters. Mhm. Ich finde es immer noch schade, dass es im zweiten Teil in Resolve keine einzige Anime-Cutscene gab, nur im ersten, nur in Adventure. Aber gut. It's always my intention not to interfere with the anime artists and their work, but sometimes minor corrections are required. It's a constant dilemma for me. Also factoring in Susato's design was how she would appear alongside Ryunosuke. In the end, I think that the contrast in conduct and bearing between the two helps to establish her as a memorable female lead. So, ich weiß leider nicht, was da oben jetzt noch für Notizen stehen. Das kann ich leider nicht lesen, aber trotzdem cool. Und da ist Sholmes. Hello, I'm Kazuya Nuri, bla bla, kennen wir schon. Ja halt, hier. Here we have the great detective himself, Herlock Sholmes. But how was I going to come up with a design to satisfy the requested unique take on the classic detective? Ist, finde ich, ziemlich gut gelungen. To begin with, I brought some steampunk elements to the Victorian era character. Then I tried to create a stylish arrangement of various period elements and some iconic characteristics of the original that I wanted to preserve. Sholmes' personal quest combines the cogwheel motive of his consulting detective business and the simple flower design of Iris' crest. The cogwheel symbolizes the industrial revolution taking place in Britain at the time. There are also overtones of the relationship between Sholmes and Iris in the motive, with Iris the flower at the center being protected by Sholmes, the cogwheel, around the outside. Da wurden sich so viele Gedanken gemacht, krass. I was careful to preserve the essential features of the great detective, such as the deerstalker and the pipe, arranging them into a character that would be instantly recognizable to all. Mhm. Sholmes' equipment is an exception to the rule in that it consists of technology belonging to a much more modern era than the game setting, and takes in fantasy elements from the world of the Great Ace Attorney. The gun Sholmes makes use of in his investigations is a percussion revolver that could actually be employed as a regular firearm. The idea is to juxtapose that with Ryunosuke's Japanese katana sword, thereby highlighting a significant difference between the Japanese and European cultures of the day. Mhm. Sehr interessant. Da stehen auch wieder ein paar Notizen, die ich leider auch wieder nicht lesen kann. When Sholmes' goggles are turned on, the shape in the center of each eyepiece lights up and rotates. It's supposed to conjure the idea of a lens attachment on a camera to complement the detective's investigations. Sadly, that couldn't be realized for Sholmes' in-game animations at this time. Ja, schade eigentlich. Aber trotzdem, seine Brille ist ganz lustig. Set. Off. On! Wunderschön. This is Sholmes' indoor attire, since I assumed he wouldn't be comfortable relaxing at home whilst wearing all his detective's paraphernalia. His hair is styled as wisps of smoke to complement the indispensable pipe. Ah, halt falsch, hier. Although the usual portrayal of Sholmes is of a man with black hair, I wanted to give him a different color to provide some variety next to the hair of Ryunosuke and the other Japanese characters. Ah, okay, deswegen hat er kein schwarzes Haar. Mhm. Verstehe ich. This is a sketch I did for the initial proposal document. The image of Sholmes in the midst of analyzing evidence played a crucial part in portraying the souped-up role forensic investigation was to play in this game. The actual character design was still not fixed at the stage, even though the general direction had been decided already. Ryunosuke da auch im Hintergrund. Wunderschön. Oh, das ist interessant. This is a very early proposal sketch. It was supposed to portray a somewhat dark London with heavy steampunk influences. Da rechts Holmes und Iris. Und da hat er noch schwarze Haare. Und einen Zylinder. Zylinder würde eigentlich auch gut passen, finde ich. Hier. In the end, the Sholmesness was too deluded, so the design was scrapped. I subsequently settled on the game's Sholmes as a man whose striking appearance is only diminished by the striking erroneousness of his transcendent deductions. Schwieriger Satz. Iris! So, Kasia Nuri, dich kenne ich schon. Here we have Iris Wilson, whose character was developed on the basic idea of a child genius. Iris brings together a number of rather eccentric elements of the game world in a subtle and controlled way. At first glance, her hair appears to be tied up in a cute style that combines elements of ribbons, bows and hearts. But in fact, her fringe follows a golden spiral, a logarithmic curve based on the golden ratio. Ehrlich? Die Golden Ratio ist in ihrem Haar implementiert, das ist ja geil. Da schlägt mein Mathematikerherz höher. Das ist cool. What appears to be ribbons of hair tied in a bow from the front are revealed from behind to be a Möbius strip. Echt, Möbius Band auch noch? A type of surface with interesting topological, Alter, voll der Mathematiker hier, topological properties signifying Iris' infinite possibilities. Das ist ja mega geil. Das ist voll der Mathematiker, den mag ich. Wie hieß er nochmal? Warte mal hier, Kasia Nuri. Du bist cool. Der ist Mathematiker im Herzen. Spricht er hier über Golden Ratio und über Möbius Band. Mega nice. I decided to make use of a flower plant motif in Iris' character design. That was partially inspired by the long history that the use of herbs and plant aromas has in Britain, but also because the idea of blending herbal teas fits naturally with Sholmes' chemistry-based investigative techniques. The gorgas, gun and knapsack are a set that match Sholmes' accoutrements. The gorgas in particular were part of the initial design and always intended not just to be a cute addition, but to lend a dubious air to Iris' appearance, to make people think there's more to her than meets the eye. Sorry übrigens, dass ich mich oft verlese, aber es ist sehr viel am Stück zu lesen, ohne Pause. Ansonsten habe ich halt immer Pause zwischendurch, weil häufiger mal nichts gesagt wird in Ace Attorney, aber hier muss ich ständig lesen, deswegen sorry, ich verlese mich oft. Iris and Sholmes' inventions are, as a rule, far more advanced than the science and technology of the era in which the game is set. The thermos flask would have been considered a magical bottle at the time, but in the game's late Victorian setting, Iris and Sholmes have already developed one and make use of it in their everyday lives. Though technologically advanced, the appearance of the inventions follows the typical style of the era. Iris carries a gun she's developed, the Aroma One, in her knapsack. Dann, these are the Felddoll charms that Iris has attached to her knapsack. They are bear and hair based on Iris and Sholmes, and were originally going to be very instrumental in the story and be shown in a lot of close-up detail. Ah, interessant. I gave a great deal of thought to their construction whilst trying to make them as fun as possible. They are particularly favorite of mine. Ich meine, die waren ja auch wichtig, aber halt nur am Ende, sonst kamen die ja nie vor. Und die sollten mal anscheinend eine größere Rolle spielen. Okay. This is an illustration from a time when I had Iris in a hat for her out and about clothing. At this stage, her character hadn't been finalized, so I drew her older than in the final game and with a more ladylike air. Das sieht sie auf jeden Fall nicht aus wie eine 10-Jährige, finde ich. Also wenn das schon von Anfang an geplant war, dass sie 10 sein sollte, dann passt das eigentliche Design von ihr besser auf jeden Fall. Ich mag auch das eigentliche Design wahrscheinlich lieber. Ja, würde ich sagen. Wegen goldenem Schnitt und wegen Möbiusband. Das ist auch interessant. These sketches were done when I was exploring some elements of a magical girl to incorporate into Iris' character design as a way of giving her more punch. She has a much brighter look here than in the previous illustration. Das stimmt, also das finde ich besser als das hier, auf jeden Fall. Die Haare sind halt hier ein bisschen langweiliger, aber sonst würde es auch passen, finde ich. Und hier nochmal. This is an illustration I drew when Iris was almost complete. It contains all of the key elements that make up her design, so her face is a little more mature in the final cut. In the end I gave her a slightly brighter and more bubbly expression and included some additional ladylike touches to produce the young Miss Wilson you all know from the game. Und die Haarfarbe ist ja auch noch anders. Ist ja pink und nicht hier. Ich meine, das hat auch ein bisschen pink, aber das ist etwas dunkler auf jeden Fall als ihre eigentliche Haarfarbe. Kasuma. So, Kasia Nuri, genau. Dich kenne ich schon. Now for Kasuma Asugi. The basic theme for Kazuma's design was of a classic young Japanese man. His constantly blowing Hachimaka headband is there to differentiate him from Ryunosuke, giving him a more confident and combative energy. There's no doubt that wherever Kazuma is, the winds of change are blowing. Whilst Kazuma clearly has the spirit of a samurai, he's also keenly aware as a visiting student hopeful of the shift in cultural attitudes arising from the Meiji Restoration. The addition of the leather gaiters and sword belt as influences from the Western world highlight the character's social awareness. Whoa, this is geil. I desperately wanted to draw Kazuma in the act of drawing his blade, so I included that in the key visual. With the exception of some dramatic finger pointing in court, there's little opportunity in the Ace Attorney series to draw pictures full of grand, sweeping gestures like this, so I'm always looking for an excuse. And I'm particularly pleased that I could really go to town with a picture of Kazuma at this large scale. Yeah, das kann man sich mal kurz auch hier so anschauen. Ziemlich cool. Das habe ich jetzt nicht mal gemacht, sogar selten nur, dass ich die Textbox weggemacht habe, sorry. Aber passt hoffentlich trotzdem. Okay. These are some sketches I did during a transition phase when we were considering who should have glasses. Eventually we settled on it being Satoru Hosonaga, Ouchie doesn't count, whose design I was also working on at the time. So Kazuma ended up with just his Hachimaki headband instead. But for a while competition for who would become the bespectacled one was fierce. ich meine, ich bin ja auch Brillenträger, aber ich finde Kazuma ohne Brille besser. Und ich finde auch, dass es zu Hosonaga wahrscheinlich besser passt, die Brille. Besser als zu Kazuma, finde ich. Ja. With the combination of the headband and the glasses, Kazuma took on a far too studious look. So although I was pleased to have explored the possibility, this was the drawing that convinced me it wasn't the right approach. Mhm, okay. This sketch was done when Kazuma's design was almost finalized. I was hoping to draw both Ryunosuke and Kazuma side by side wearing matching hats and cloaks. That's a picture I'd like to draw one day. Ja, das ist wirklich ziemlich final. Das Gesicht sieht schon ein bisschen anders aus. Auch ziemlich gut, finde ich sogar. Hier. Ist ja auch, wie gesagt, nicht so ein großer Unterschied. Aber das würde auch passen. Since Kazuma plays such an important role in the story, I put a lot of energy into giving him a striking appearance that immediately reveals his dependability and kind-heartedness as well as his relentless determination. I really hope he makes a memorable impression on everyone who plays the game. Ja, hat er schon. Ja, aber so gutherzig ist er nicht. Der ist nur nach Großbritannien gegangen, um Mord zu begehen, wie wir herausgefunden haben. So, dann von Seeks. Hello, I'm Kasia Nuri. Ja, so hier. Here we have the British prosecutor Barak van Seeks, whose character was to be themed on the sinister Reaper of the Bailey demigods. Despite the God of Death theme suggested for the design, I decided to avoid taking that too literally, instead trying to produce a character whose bearing and presence conjured ideas of death and darkness. To that end, I took inspiration from vampires, werewolves, fallen angels and the like, incorporating lots of dark elements into the man's design and bringing them all together by portraying him as a member of the aristocracy. Ich finde, Van Seeks hat ein richtig starkes Design. Vielleicht hat er sogar so rein designmäßig das beste Design von allen Charakteren. Würde ich sogar fast sagen. Ich finde, sein Design ist richtig gut. Okay. I made his clothing extremely ostentatious, oder so, drawing on elements from a variety of traditionally British ceremonial and military attire. I also added some extra ribcage-like detail around the midriff. His saber is supposed to contrast directly with Ryunosuke's Japanese katana, bringing out the difference between East and West, the samurai versus the knight. Mm-hmm. As with Kazuma's headband, I knew that realizing Van Seek's cloak in-game would be technically complex, but I also knew that it lent a lot of credence to his dark persona, so I was quite insistent about it. The end result was that the aristocratic prosecutor's flamboyance and Dracula-esque darkness are both instantly appreciable, and I'm very grateful to the staff for their determination in achieving that goal. Those... Okay, oder these, nicht those. Rough sketches were my attempt at consolidating my ideas about the prosecutor's image. His look needed to be more than just piercing. It needed to portray a sad and tortured soul as well. Aber das sieht auch gar nicht so schlecht aus, finde ich. Okay. Das sieht nicht so gut aus. This is a very early illustration. I came up with and rejected a lot of different ideas myself over a long period of time. I submitted only the one that resonated most with me to Mr. Takumi and was given the go-ahead to proceed. Ja, also da finde ich das finale Design von Van Seeks viel, viel besser als das hier. Aber ich meine, das ist ja auch jetzt nichts Schlimmes oder so, weil... Sorry. Ist natürlich schwierig, von Anfang an da gleich mit einem perfekten Design aufzukommen, aber ist auf jeden Fall gut, dass, wie hieß er nochmal, mein Mathematiker-Zeichner-Freund, dass er sich da verbessert hat. Among the main cast, this character underwent a unique development process. I didn't show anybody my designs for the prosecutor, including the drawings from this stage of the process. Sehr interessant. I like to consider lots of options in the early stages, so I produce a wide range of drawings at the start of the process. Even if I thought an idea might not be quite right, I put it to paper so I could home in on the perfect design. Sieht echt komplett anders aus, krass. Die anderen Designs waren echt von Anfang an eigentlich schon halbwegs nah dran, aber hier ist echt komplett anders, als wie Van Sieg's im finalen Spiel aussieht. Auch wieder komplett anders. This is a proposal drawing I made just before settling on the final design. Personally, I was quite fond of this one. He has a more paint expression than the final version, and the cloak is modeled on a raven's plumage. I've always enjoyed Dark Heroes, so I really like all the elements of Van Sieg's design and his overall appearance. Aber er sieht hier nicht ganz so finster aus, wie sein finales Design. Das ist ja besser, wenn er finsterer aussieht. Finde ich. Also ich finde sein finales Design, wie gesagt, richtig gut. Ja. So, hello, I'm Kazuya Nuri. Aber wo sind wir jetzt eigentlich? Bei irgendwas. Dann Special gibt's noch. From the Vault. Das sind, glaube ich, auch wieder Spoiler. Und hier nochmal Poster oder so. Okay. Ja. Title Image. Ja. This picture includes all of the main characters and was produced in the same vein as the artwork I came up with for Phoenix Wright Ace Attorney. To make it instantly obvious that this title is from the same series. Genau, das ist vom Design her, wie das aufgeteilt ist, exakt gleich wie auch in den Haupt-Ace Attorneys, vor allem im ersten Ace Attorney, aber auch in den weiteren, glaube ich, auch. Da war halt dann ganz links Phoenix, da war Maya, dann Mia und Edgeworth, wahrscheinlich. Schätze ich mal, nicht ganz sicher. Aber auf jeden Fall die Aufteilung da mit vier Charakteren, die so nebeneinander sind, war da auch exakt dieselbe. Und soll eben auch daran erinnern, erfolgreich würde ich sagen. It was used as the key visual in the early stages of development. Okay. In this section of the gallery, I'd like to present some of the character design drawings for the less major characters, okay? That were created during the development process. I hope you enjoyed it. Genau, wir hatten ja jetzt bisher die Hauptcharaktere und jetzt kommen die Nebencharaktere und da, wie die Designs von denen sich verändert haben. So, Kazuya Nuri, dich kenne ich schon. Now we move on to the contingent oder so from the Empire of Japan, Yujin Mikotoba. He's Susato's father and a university professor, so I had to make sure his expression could be seen as both kindly and stern. I've established the cherry blossom as the emblem of the Mikotoba family, and Yujin's pink kaori overcoat clasp is modeled on a cherry tree in full bloom. The hem of Susato's Hakama trousers also carries the family crest. Rechts sieht er eher aus wie ein Brite als links, finde ich. Taketsuji Auchi, this character's design crystallized in an instant. I verbally suggested the idea of a John-Mage Topknot to Mr. Takumi and he immediately agreed. Ja, passt auch sehr gut. I made some sketches of Auchi with round glasses on, since they were the norm in Meiji Japan, but it was just too much of a departure from his descendants' usual look. So I reverted to the normal shape of glasses we're all familiar with. Ah, genau, da unten. Interessant, mit runden Gläsern eben. Wie das aus Meiji Japan eigentlich eher bekannt ist. Aber ja, ich finde auch, die eckigen Gläser passen besser, weil ja eben die Verbindung zu Auchi Pain erkennbar sein soll. Ja. The Judge of the Supreme Court of Judicature in Japan. I decided to take a different direction with this judge as compared to previous judges in the series, to accentuate the military atmosphere of the Japanese courtroom at the time. Since he passes judgment on wrongdoers, I thought I'd take inspiration from the portrayal of the Buddhist god Enma. Then I added the beard and some flames into my design. Also ursprünglich fand ich eigentlich das Design vom Richter ein bisschen seltsam, weil das halt wirklich nicht so klassisch ist. Vor allem aber, wenn man halt das ganze Spiel kennt. Ich meine, ich kann ja hier spoilern, ne? Weil es werden ja eh gleich noch Spoiler kommen. Wenn man halt weiß, dass er auch einer von den Bösewichten war, dann passt das Design richtig gut, finde ich. Im ersten Moment fand ich's halt schon auch ganz cool, aber halt ungewohnt. Aber wenn man alles über das Spiel weiß, dann passt es übelst gut, das Design, finde ich. Ja. I made this gavel golden and styled it on the traditional Uchide no Kozuchi, magic hammer of Japanese legend oder so. Kenn ich nicht. Kyurio Korikuta. Since this man is a merchant, I initially decided to base his design on Ebisu oder so. One of the seven gods of fortune and the traditional Japanese god of prosperity in business. But when I showed my rough sketches to Mr. Takumi, for some reason the idea of Korekuta being long and thin came up, so I switched to another of the gods, Fukurokuchu, as a more fitting source of inspiration. I wanted to have him constantly eating sticky mochi rice cakes, which would get caught in his throat, but it seemed a little too dangerous to portray. So with great self-restraint, I stopped myself. LOL. Kommen hier eigentlich alle Nebencharaktere oder wie? So ziemlich. Eieiei. Okay, da haben wir noch einige. Also wir werden auch in diesem Part nicht die komplette Galerie schaffen, weil es gibt ja auch noch Videos, die man sich anschauen kann, die kommen dann erst im nächsten Part. Ist wirklich sehr viel hier. So, Eisenosa. I was going for a stereotypically military man of the time, in order to give players a clear sense of the era. He appears to be a regular, smartly turned out soldier, but on his back he harbors a great secret. At first we considered having Eisen fold cranes in secret as a sideline business, hiding his paper creations behind his back. But after fleshing out the details with Mr. Takumi, the idea of Eidonosa came kicking and screaming into the words. The constantly runny nose is an expression of the poor nutrition children of the time had to suffer, and Isa's mustache was deliberately designed so it would be easy for young Ido to tuck. LOL. And of course the similarity of the father-son hairstyle is another detail not to be missed. Sehr schön. Satoru Hosonaga, from the role he plays in the scenarios, I could sense this character had potential for further involvement, so I gave him a more believable appearance than other witnesses in the game. His design is built on the idea of a young man with fragile good looks who wouldn't be out of place in even the most delicate of situations. The reason for the chic motif on the napkin he carries as a waiter at La Carnival was as a kind of covert foreshadowing of Cheese's involvement, and because the restaurant was originally going to specialize in serving game. Ah, interessant. So, dann Cheese Bread. Being the first Western character you encounter as the story starts to unfold in Japan, I decided to make her a somewhat bizarre fantasy-style gentlewoman, who would leave a strong visual impression. It was a deliberate attempt to heighten expectations, or trepidation, about the overseas voyage soon to follow. The mask she wears was styled to pair with the eyes of the swan on her head. I almost eliminated the chicks from Cheese's design on numerous occasions, but they made it through in the end. Ja, sie hat auch ein sehr cooles Design, finde ich. Nikolina Pavlova. I designed Nikolina to have an immediately obvious Russian appearance. Her image was based on the idea of a Russian fairy, and I implemented her as a beautiful, reticent young woman of fair complexion. Due to the nature of the story, I was constrained in terms of her clothing, but since there aren't many orthodox female forms in this game, I did try to bring out the telltale lines of a young lady even through the layers of her disguise. Her feline friend is obviously a Russian blue. Ja, man sieht sie ja auch hier dann als Ballerina. Aber da hat sie noch auf jeden Fall ein anderes Design ein bisschen als das Finale. So, jetzt stellt er sich nochmal vor. Warum? Let me show you some of the character designs and scene settings and artworks. Warum stellt er sich jetzt nochmal vor? Keine Ahnung. Aber der englische Richter auf jeden Fall. Now we move on to the contingent oder so from the British Empire. Achso, weil man die alle halt in den ersten beiden Episoden, also in Japan oder auf dem Weg nach London getroffen hat. Und jetzt kommen halt alle, die in London waren. Okay, deswegen. The Judge of the Old Bailey. I'd made the Japanese judge quite severe, in keeping with the feel of the Japanese courtroom, so I decided to make his English counterpart follow the more kindly appearance of the series' regular judge. Genau. For example, in contrast to the jagged beard of the Japanese judge, this judge's beard is more fluffy in nature. The wig, by the way, is just a visual gag. That's actually what judges of the day wore. Ah. Ja, stimmt, das habe ich sogar, glaube ich, auch schon manchmal gesehen. Ja. I also researched the sort of clothing British judges would have worn in that period and used that to create a design that's unique to this game. Ah, okay, jetzt die Geschworenen. Jurors. I was given instructions that the jurors didn't need any particular idiosyncrasies, but just in case, I thought I'd design some characters with a variety of unique traits, and it was those designs that were picked. LOL. Ja, finde ich auch gut so, dass auch die Geschworenen auch Eigenheiten an sich haben und nicht standardmäßig sind. As a result, there was really little difference between the jurors and the witnesses, which meant I'd given myself a lot of extra work to do. But seeing court battles that include both jurors and witnesses justified all the efforts. Finde ich auch. Soseki Natsume. Mr. Takumi had asked for Soseki to come across as someone with a very nervous disposition and erratic behavior, so I included that his facial expression would have to be a key part of his design. I approached the design from that angle, playing around with various different facial expressions. Even though he's based on a real person, the Soseki of this game has a unique appearance with some heavily exaggerated features. The emotion expressed by his eyes is a particularly important part of his design. Meine Stimme ist nach dem Part komplett nutzlos. I had specifically been asked to include the cat, but I sketched a tricolor calico at Soseki's feet and was delighted when Wagahai was picked up and used in the game. Aber das war anfangs gar nicht geplant, dass die Katze vorkommen würde, aber hat er einfach so reingezeichnet und dann wurde es übernommen. Nice. Ich weiß übrigens auch nicht, ob hier Kazuya Nuri, ob das Mann oder Frau ist. Kazuya hört sich eher männlich an, aber ich bin mir nicht sicher, oder? Ich habe gerade kurz überlegen müssen, woher ich den Namen Kazuya kenne, aber aus Smash natürlich. Und da ist Kazuya auch männlich, deswegen schätze ich mal, dass der Artist hier Kazuya auch männlich ist. Deswegen werde ich eher sagen, wenn ich über ihn spreche, über meinen Mathematikerfreund. So, jetzt, John and Cho and Gary Depp. I really had to work hard on this pair, since they're so intimately tied up with the story. The guiding principle for the design was a sun and moon silhouette, along with the idea of a pufferfish for Joanne. Moment, was? Sun and moon silhouette? Ach lol, jetzt, lol, das ist mir noch nie aufgefallen. Hier, John, Gary Depp, hat als Silhouette, wenn man ihn von der Seite betrachtet, sieht sein Kopf aus wie ein Halbmond. Und sie sieht aus wie eine Sonne. Krass, das habe ich noch nie bemerkt. Lol. Das ist cool. Compared to the newlyweds of Constable and Mrs. Beat with their passionate love for each other, the Gary Depps are an older couple and I wanted to show a different form of love in their relationship. Und das sind die beiden, die sind sehr süß zusammen. Rowley and Pat Beat. There are a lot of pairs of witnesses who appear together in this game, but I had a firm idea of how I wanted these two to interact from the outset, so I actually worked backwards from here. I designed them as a single unit, two people moving and acting as one. The scarf that goes around both of their necks is a good example of that. They were modeled on the idea of dolls, wooden marionettes or porcelain dolls, and are supposed to have a fantasy world image despite being virtually penniless, to bring out their genuine and their sweet personalities. Mit dem Herz dazwischen, yay! So, dann Gregson. Und China sogar auch. Tobias Gregson. I designed Gregson as a stereotypical Scotland Yard detective of the day. His collar turned up and the obligatory packet of fish and chips in his hand. As he's always stuffing them in his pockets, I imagine his hands and the lining of his pockets are constantly covered in ship fat. LOL! Whenever I see him eating, my stomach starts to rumble. Gina the Straight. Gina was the character who underwent the most changes as a result of story rewrites. Ah, okay. Originally, she wasn't going to be a pickpocket at all. Consequently, I had to redesign her in the latter stages of the production process. Her outfit helps to portray her complete lack of money, and Mr. Takumi requested that I make her clothes not quite fit properly as well. That's the reason why her shirt is too large for her, for example. From my perspective, I wanted to allow her feminine spark to shine through from beneath her boyish appearance. May Strongheart. I was aiming for a character who had an immediately pale presence and whose bearing was overwhelmingly intimidating. My initial designs were quite militaristic, but Mr. Takumi asked for Strongheart to have an intellectual image instead, which gave rise to his current look, more reminiscent of a clergyman. His name, Vortex in Japanese, gave inspiration for the styling of his hair. There are also elements of unicorns woven subtly into his design, since the unicorn features in the British Royal Coat of Arms. Einhorn? Wirklich? Seine Haare oder wie? Finde ich jetzt eigentlich nicht, dass der viele Einhorn-Designs hat, aber gut. For example in profile, okay, the front strand of Stronghead's hair looks like a unicorn's horn, as does the cane on his sides. Weiß ich nicht. Ich meine, sehe ich auch aus wie ein Einhorn? Ich habe eine ähnliche Frisur wie er. Naja. I also drew from elements of other creatures, like the Black Panther, to portray not only his intellectual prowess, but also his ferocity. For his clothing, I tried to bring in features found in prosecutors' outfits. Agathe Benedict. This character was designed to have the appearance of the quintessential English gentleman. I had a strong sense that I wanted to go in this direction with this character, so I put a lot of effort into his design and was very relieved when it was approved. His clothing is detailed with elements related to bricks and brick buildings. And of course he has numerous unusual flourishes and affections to surprise players, so if any of you haven't seen them yet, do look out for them in the game. Well, I'd like to give more details about other characters as well, but I think we'll have to call it a day. Oh, schade. I've really enjoyed this brief opportunity to discuss the game's development with you. Thank you for taking the time to read my explanations, and I hope our paths cross again soon. Yay! Gern geschehen. Ich muss mich eher bedanken. Vielen Dank, sehr cool. Jetzt haben wir noch hier zwei besondere Poster. Und dann hier noch mehr Zeug. Der Part wird auch wieder sehr lang. So, Brothers of Ambitious Dreams. Since there were already commemorative group pictures at the end of each game, I sought to avoid the same themes and motives in these pictures. I also didn't want to take away from the good vibes after finishing each title, so I gave it a lot of thought. In the end, I settled on using just Ryunosuke and Kazuma, as the two of them are the embodiment of the Great Ace Attorney. This illustration tells of the hope and ambition in their hearts, just before they set sail for Great Britain. Standing shoulder to shoulder, they turn towards the same future at the start of their journey. Looking at this after experiencing the events of adventures, it's like going back in time, and it's sure to stir up all sorts of emotions. I drew a similar picture once for the Adventures artbook, but as this piece was going to be used in a game, I made it more like a snapshot of something that might have happened in the story itself. Brothers of the Dawn, I turned to the iconic final scene at daybreak between Ryunosuke and Kazuma for inspiration in the symbolic illustration of their parting of ways. The image of the sun rising between their crossed... Nochmal. The image of the sun rising between their crossed swords was something I desperately wanted to include in the game, and it turned out to be a very emotionally powerful scene. It hints at their futures whilst showing the metaphorical dawning of a new age of the law. Rushing off down their respective paths with conviction in their hearts, Ryunosuke and Kazuma dash away in opposite directions from the rising sun, until the day their fates would cross once more. Whereas the two of them were facing the same direction in Brothers of Ambitious Dreams, Brothers of the Dawn presents a visual and thematic counterpart to complete the set. Ziemlich cool. Hat das auch mein Mathematikerfreund geschrieben? Der könnte Poet auch noch werden. Nebenbei. So, dann haben wir hier noch mehr Zeug. Alter, wie viele Texte sind das noch? Ach, das sind die alternativen Kostüme. Okay. Wie viele sind das? Ach, leck mich doch am Arsch. Ja, okay. Introduction. Ich meine, das ist ja auch voll interessant, ne? Aber der Part wird halt viel zu lang und meine Stimme wird leiden. So, I'm Kazuya Nuri, Art Director and Character Designer for the Great Ace Attorney. Jetzt haben wir jemand anderen. Ah, nee, gar nicht wahr. Ist ja immer noch... Ich habe den Namen verwechselt. Ist immer noch derselbe. Ist immer noch Kazuya Nuri. Hat das alles nur ein Dude gezeichnet oder wie? This is where I'll be sharing some of the designs and reference documents I drew for the second game, Resolve. Before I begin, please be aware that there will be a large number of big spoilers both in my comments and in the illustrations themselves, so I very strongly recommend finishing the two main games before going any further. Ryunosuke Naruhodo. This character illustration was used in promotion materials for the original release of Resolve. In it, Ryunosuke strikes a resolute, let's do this pose, with his chest out and his collar straight. Along with his armband, katana, university collar pin and arm guard, I strove to capture everything unique to Ryunosuke in a roughly triangular shape with his stance. Iris's homemade suit, I often like to create... costumes that speak to a character's backstory or personality over how visually striking they are, but they can lead to this design feeling rather uninteresting after the first time you see it. To avoid that pitfall, I remember wanting to make this outfit feel connected to the story somehow, whilst expanding on the world of the Great Ace Attorney. So I added a few things here and there to spark the imagination and give you something new to find each time you play through the game with it on. One of these elements is little Shunosuke standing on Ryunosuke's shoulder that Iris made. If you look very careful, its head actually moves in tandem with Ryunosuke, but perhaps it's a bit too subtle. Das habe ich sogar, glaube ich, bemerkt. Ja. The line and cut of his suit were also designed to complement Prosecutor Azugi's, making them a fine pair in court. Ah, okay. Ich mag auf jeden Fall sein alternatives Design auch ziemlich gerne. Ja. Dann Susato, das finde ich auch ziemlich cool, ihr alternatives Design. Susato Mikotoba. In her previous outing, her character illustration portrayed her as the ideal refined lady, a Yamato Nadeshiko. So this time I thought to show Susato's sweet and spirited side instead for Resolve. This also allowed me to strike a better balance between Susato and Ryunosuke visually, when they were to be featured together side by side. dann das homemade dress von Iris. Susata and Ryunosuke's outfits were both created by Iris. As such, they share a number of design elements with Iris's new outdoors attire and Shoms' regular clothes. I suppose you could say they are Susata and Ryunosuke's uniforms for the Shoms consulting detective agency. In keeping with the period setting, Susato's usual look is a very modest female student's attire, but I felt that it kept me from bring out her full feminine charm. From bringing out, oder? Aber egal. So I employed Iris's help to unlock it in this costume. Okay, dann Shoms. Herlock Shoms. I thought to draw Shoms facing towards this time, in contrast to his publicity illustration for the first game. But as I drew, it struck me that the pose I'd chosen wasn't very Shoms-like at all. As I struggled to come up with something more befitting, I was asked to create a teaser illustration in which Shoms and Ryunosuke would stand shoulder to shoulder, at which point it became vital that I balanced their look visually. It led to what I feel is Shoms' most natural stance, the three-quarter pose. While he wound up standing at almost the exact same angle, and I experienced a ton of deja vu as I drew, I swear it's a totally different picture, lol. The insert illustration, the enlightened Shoms on the left, captures the moment in which Shoms hits upon his latest transcendental idea that transcends both time and space, probably right as Iris was about to get some shut-eye too. So a Japanese chummy mix for Ian. I'd wanted an excuse to dress Shoms up in Japanese clothing since production of the first game, but after the second game came and went with no such opportunity either, I'd started to give up hope. That's when talk of alternate costumes arose, and I swiftly jumped at the chance to turn my idea into reality. Of the three new outfits, Shoms is the one I had the clearest idea of from the get-go, so his was the first to be completed. I originally imagined that it would be something he could wear in Japan, so it was even more Japanese in design at first, but as it was meant to be a costume for Great Britain, I pulled back on it a little to bring it in line with the other two. I also came up with Japanese-style outfits for Iris and Van Sieg's, actually, but all that was needed were three, so unfortunately those two other designs will never see the light of day. Oh, sehe ich die hier vielleicht noch? Unlike Ryunosuke and Susato's outfits, which are made by Iris, Shoms made his by himself. Also, the mask he wears is not a typical Kitsune Fox mask, but a Wagahai cat mask. Wunderschön. Ich meine, Iris hat ja ein bisschen ein anderes Kostüm bekommen, wo wir auf der Great Exhibition waren. Iris Wilson. I strove to bring out a cuteness befitting a child of her age more than in the previous game's illustration. I also wanted to show off her knapsack and the charms hanging off from it, which had both been hidden behind her. Also of importance was how she would look when paired with Shoms in various promotional materials. Outdoors attire, I'd actually designed this during the production of the first game, so I was thrilled to be able to bring it out again after I'd put it away for various reasons. The jacket she wears over her indoor clothes is based on a steampunk aviators, to which I added elements that made her more resemble the little bear shape. Little bear shaped lucky charm she's made of herself. Incorporating flowers and hearts into the design, I landed on a mildly Eastern motif for the decorations on her head, and when she lowers her goggles, she looks just like her lucky charm. Berg van Sieg's. I drawn two versions of van Sieg's, one with and one without his cloak, so that they might be used during the early and final days of the first game's promotion respectively to show him in two different lights. Unfortunately, only the cloaked one where most of him was shrouded to show his Reaper of the Bailey facade was ever used, so I made sure that his resolve illustration would show both his dark demigod and aristocratic prosecutor sides. Ich kann überhaupt nicht mehr lesen. Schlimm. So viel. I had also hoped we could create a new in-game character model based on this open kept look in the second game, but sadly it was not to be. There were a number of mysteries surrounding Van Sieg's related to his past and the Reaper moniker at the end of the first game, so it was a great relief to finally resolve them all in the second. Being able to draw him as he really is and show a different side of him from the Reaper was the greatest catharsis for me. Sehr schön. Eieiei. Master Prentice. I'd suggested the idea of giving Van Sieg a young male judicial assistant during the development of the first game, and whilst it was well received, he couldn't be included due to time restraints. I made suggestions anew during the second game's development, and was told, it'll be hard to add a new character now, but let me see what I can do. I certainly didn't expect things to turn out the way they did. Originally, I proposed that this younger judicial assistant could act as a rival to Susato, and that he and Van Sieg would enjoy a close and heated dynamic. Instead, their cooler, more distant relationship worked out rather well, I think. Visually, he was to serve as a backdrop to his mentor, coupled with the need to create the biggest impact possible when his true identity is finally revealed. Very little besides his mask is visible in order to create an aura of mystery. Prosecutor Kazuma Azugi. From a narrative perspective, Kazuma represents the theme of confluence and contrast between East and West. As such, his prosecutor's outfit is based on Western clothing with Eastern flourishes. Another major task for me was how to change his appearance whilst keeping to the core elements of his design and overall form. For example, the swapping of Kazuma's university student uniform for a military-style dress uniform. Other examples include the replacement of his Eastern Hachimaki headband for a Western escort tie, and his Japanese katana for a European saber, and his eventually use of both swords at the same time. His main colors take inspiration from the Japanese flag and white snakes, which hold spiritual significance in Japanese folklore. His family crest, which is based on real Chanome snake eye crests and mask, are both snake-themed too. Echt, der hat so viel Schlangenthemen in sich? Das habe ich auch gar nicht bemerkt. Interessant. He's also predominantly in white to stand in contrast with Ryunosuke's black uniform. I was completely sure this was the way to go when I envisioned how his dramatic return would play out when he regained his memories. A bright form emerging from under a dark cloak like a beam of light chasing the haze and darkness away. And also as though he were shedding the dark varsity check of his past like a layer of old skin. Ich sage ja, er sollte auch Poet werden. Like von Sieg, the details in Kazuma's design serve to convey the affluence of the prosecution whilst in contrast. The relative simplicity and modernity of his outfit conveys a sense of progress. Ich bin jetzt erst bei 7, willst du mich verarschen? Clint von Sieg's. Clint only appears in illustrations throughout the game, but as he is a key figure in the story, I approach his design as though he were a main character. I set about creating his design by retaining certain elements to create similarities between the brothers, whilst inserting new elements to contrast the differences between Barak's Yin and Clint's Yang. As with Barak's navy blue, Clint's red jacket is a reference to the traditional colors of the uniforms of the Queen's Guard, and was just a thing to convey his positivity and brilliance. First introduced in Adventures, the crossed swords in the Van Sieg's family crest are actually also a representation of the two brothers, though as the emblem was used over many generations, I can't very well say it's only all about them. Using a pair of crossed swords as a belt buckle also hints at how they've become bound by honor and glory, which was holding them back in various ways. The badge on Clint's chest was always meant to serve as a memento of him for his little brother, which we were finally able to show and resolve. Narratively, I was able to make one very influential contribution in relation to Clint. One day, I very boldly proposed to the director, Mr. Takumir, how about making Clint's hunting dog the Baskerville Hound? At the time, Mr. Takumir himself hadn't quite hit upon how to solve the Baskerville problem yet, so he wasn't even sure if he was going to include it in the story. Therefore, I figured I had nothing to lose by suggesting it. Aristocrats often went hunting with their dogs back then, so it seemed like a period-appropriate way to show Clint's social status and charismatic personality, and connect him to the specifics of the case. I also suggested placing a certain vital piece of evidence in a very specific location. Okay. Da sieht man auch den kleinen Van Sieg's. Ist Van Sieg's so viel, also Barak meine ich, ist Barak so viel jünger als Clint? Nee, sind sie nicht eigentlich, oder? Weil da rechts ist halt Barak ein Kind und Clint schon erwachsen? Keine Ahnung. Genshin Azugi. My goal with this design was to convey Genshin's standing as the head of the Azugi clan, a family of samurai warriors going back generations. And as Kazuma's father, he also shares a number of traits with his son. The first is a thin white strip of cloth he uses to tie his hair back, which flutters in the winds of change that blow around him. The second is the western suit and boots he dons. By virtue of his willingness to travel to Great Britain, I felt that he too must have been a progressive thinker, so I made his clothing resemble those of Kazuma. And of course he wears the great sword Karuma by his side as well. In addition to these shared traits, I gave Genjin a slim yet athletic build to give the impression that he's very fit and light on his feet. Family Crest, Swords and Snake Eyes, was the theme that was established for the Azugi's Family Crest during the development of the first game, but seeing as they descended from samurai and that this was something I could use to hint at the darkness lurking in the depth of Kazuma's personality, I simply fell into this design as the most obvious choice. The fact that I could use it in a meaningful way in Resolve and that I could tie it into the apprentice's design is something I raise a toast to my past self for. Alter, ist auch so viel. Warum ist es so viel überall? Alter, es ist so viel! Eieiei. Yuji Mikotoba. Mikotoba's surprising past is finally revealed in Resolve. Of course, all of his backstory had been set during the first game's development, so everything I'm about to finally share, I drew during my time on Adventures. Mikotoba's western suit that appears in Resolve was actually designed in conjunction with the Japanese kimono. In fact, the color of his suit is more or less what decided the color of his Sakama trousers for me. Therefore, the real focus of his design was not on his relation to Susato as a father, but rather on his relation to Sholmes as the great detective's legendary partner Dr. Wilson. On the surface, he's a serious-looking man with a soft, amiable charm. Young Mikotoba was designed to pair well with Sholmes and to seem more full of vim and vigor than his older self, wrapped in an aura of style and gentle kindness. Young Mikotoba is one of my favorite designs, and whilst I couldn't show him off visually in the game itself, I'm glad I'm able to share him with you here. Mhm, also rechts oben, der junge Mikotoba, sieht wirklich cool aus, finde ich auch. The legendary pair, here we have Sholmes and his partner in their youth. In my mind, young Sholmes was much rougher around the edges than he is now. Stimmt, da ist Sholmes ja auch jung. Ja, stimmt, in der Mitte sind sie ja auch beide jung, genau. And so I suppose everyone goes through that at some point in their life, right? And I'd like to think that it's thanks to living with Iris that his rough edges have been sanded down quite a bit now. Because it's the people and life experiences we hold dearest that change us the most. The Mikotoba step, the splashiest secret of Resolve dubbed the Mikotoba step by the development team. I propose this is a way to give Mikotoba a unique yet complementary animation to show Mrs. grand flourishes and gestures during their dance of deduction without completely deviating from his usual gentlemanly ways. After all, a true partner is one with the confidence to bring their own unique talents to the fight. Ich kann übrigens auch zoomen, sehe ich gerade, das habe ich gar nicht bemerkt. Genau, man könnte auch zoomen. Yay. Wunderschön. So, Ryutaro Naruhodo. Since women aren't allowed in the Japanese courtrooms of our game, it quickly became a question of how to present Susato as a man. Design-wise, there were two options. A look so unique that neither the player nor the other characters would know who she was, or one where the player would soon figure it out, but the in-game characters would remain oblivious. The first idea would have made things very difficult, and since there were no qualms about using the second, I was able to finalize a masculine look for Susato without any fuss. On top of technical limitations, not being able to cut her hair considering what was to happen in the story after the first episode left design options very limited anyway, so the second choice was the only realistic one we ever really had. I worked in a number of things such as making the jacket just a little too big and the sleeves just a little too long to keep her design soft and cement the girl disguise as a boy look without overselling it. Remember me. Rei actually didn't exist at all in the first draft of the story. The only new character slated to appear in episode 1 was Manimemo, and the defendant was Mikotoba, whose defense was to be handled by Susato. A series of thoughts struck me when I read that draft. First, I wasn't sure it was such a good idea to have Mikotoba be the defendant, and also have him standing next to his own daughter, giving her advice on how best to represent his case. Second, a whole episode featuring nothing but a bunch of old men would make for a very dull color palette. Sure, Susato was there, but she's dressed as a man, too. Compared to the vibrancy of Adventures, it just felt lacking, I thought. So along with the feedback, I sent in my wish for a female student character to be added who could be either Susato's best friend or a younger schoolmate who absolutely adores her. This wasn't just for the sake of the visuals, but also to create a parallel structure between Susato and Ryunosuke, and the legal situation they find themselves in with their respective best friends. I believe this would serve to build anticipation in players as they come to see the similarities with the first episode of Adventures, and show yet another side of Susato adding depth to her character. Seishiro Jigoku, knowing from the outset that Jigoku would play a different role in Resolve, I folded elements of the Buddhist god of Hell and Judgment, Great King Enma, into his design. I also designed his suit at around the same time. The shape of his head is reminiscent of the judge's head he wears at the Supreme Court in Japan, and his unusually hiking build for a Japanese man is thanks to his love of martial arts such as judo and karate. Karate, oder so. The buttons on his suit also reflect Japanese and Buddhist imagery, such as family crests in the shape of Dharma wheels, Rin Pomon, and other 8-spot crests. In general, whilst his beard is shaped like licks of flames. The lines of his suits are meant to invoke the look of a clergyman, similar to Strongheart. In the world of the Great Ace Attorney, a judge's ruling is not unlike the word of a god, after all. Satoru Hosonaga, when Mr. Takumi was looking for ideas on where to set the Japanese episode at the start of the second game's development, I suggested the seaside or a sea bathing area. It was clearly not a setting we were going to be able to use in the British episodes, and considering when the game was to be released, the original release was in the summer, it seemed like a great match. I also thought it would be easier to generate excitement at a glance if we could show some favorites returning in bathing attire from that era. The first swimming costume that I completed for was Hosonaga. Mr. Takumi asked that I place something on the inspector's head so that he might have something sticking out above the water during his submarine stakeout. After some brainstorming, I hit upon the idea of a turtle figurine, with a cute little head that would wobble to and fro that I especially enjoy. Thanks to all that sun during his seaside stakeout, Hosonaga also now looks a little healthier with his new tan. There are, however, a few spots where his tan line is visible on closer inspection, wirklich? Like the area around his around the straps of his sorry straw sandals, and the hems of his swimming costume around his neck and arms. Moment. Man kann 10 Lines da sehen? Ich sehe keine. Egal. For comparison, I've provided an illustration of his usual pale save on the bottom right. Das stimmt natürlich. Er hat auf jeden Fall, das ist mir gar nicht aufgefallen, er hat da ein bisschen Farbe auf jeden Fall bekommen, wo er in der Sonne war. Aber hier, Tan Lines ist doch, sind doch, wie sagt man am Deutschen eigentlich? Halt, wenn man in der Sonne liegt und man hat halt irgendwas an, dann halt Streifen, die da zu sehen sind oder so, von der Kleidung, die man anhatte. Wie nennt man das im Deutschen eigentlich? Egal. Sieht man das bei Hosonaga hier? Also ich sehe da nichts davon. Egal. So, Taketsuji Auchi. After his precious top knot was given the job in the first game, the Auchi of the second is a man who's finally begun his own cultural revolution. So I was given the task of revolutionizing his hairline design. I settled on the look of a fallen samurai or Buddhist monk with only the small tuft he'd carefully nurtured being the new addition. Soseki Natsume. Soseki was in a suit for his appearance in the first game, but now he was not only back in Japan, but a literary sensation. So as befits an author of that era, I traded his suit jacket for a Haori jacket. I drew him once in a full kimono as well, but it was simply too Japanese and visually uninteresting. Plus it took away from the sharp, frenetic gesticulations our Soseki is known for, so I left the cloth under the Haori western. The other reason is that Soseki still has much to achieve as a rider, so this was a way for me to show his transition towards greatness. He's covered in kittens in this illustration because you can't help but think cats when you hear Soseki. But actually, this is also related to one way I thought we might make Soseki's animations more amusing and charming. I thought it would enhance even the previous game's animations to have these three clingy kittens cling on even harder as they are swung about by Soseki's wild gesticulations, whilst they cry meow, meow, meow. But due to time constraints, we were only able to bring a little of that to life in the credits. Speaking of which, when we settled on the seaside setting, I did consider putting Soseki in just a fondoshi loincloth, but that didn't go anywhere. Write many memo. As a young journalist, I imagined he'd be out in the sun a lot chasing after leads, so I started by giving him a tan and a lean, fit figure. And the look of someone who's already... Ach man, Alter. Who's ready to do anything to get the story. Sorry, ich kann überhaupt nicht mehr lesen. Und es gibt noch so viele Texte, die noch fehlen. The newspaper he works for was originally going to be called Taito Shimban, the Imperial Capital Times, but it didn't seem right to have such a respectable sounding publication print gossip and hearsay. So from his very grain-themed name, Mame Momi in Japanese, which means unhusked bean, I suggested that he work for a small agency called Daikoku Shimbun, Five Grains News, from Daikokuten, who is the god of five grains. The base of rice and rice stalks on his armband are a reflection of that. So, jetzt kommen wir zum zweiten Fall. Jetzt habe ich die Hälfte. Ungefähr. Eieiei. William Shakespeare. The jumping off point of Shakespeare's design was one simple word. Shakespeare. He looks glamorous at first, but the closer you look, the more pretentious his strange stage costume seems. It certainly feels like a period costume, but it soon becomes apparent just how out of a place it is, even in Victorian times. The thin veneer of his flashy clothes seem to suggest wealth, but he's actually as poor as they come. I knew from the beginning that I wanted those gaudy, oversized gems to come flying off during his final breakdown, so I liberally applied them all over his costume. Along the bottom of his jacket, I'd attached a number of bells so that he'd make a jingling sound whenever he moved. My intention was to make him seem annoying and shallow, but when we actually added the sound effects to bring my vision to life, we found that it was simply too much, so we ultimately left them out. Adrian B. Meterman and Lady Quinn B. Altamont. From the description of his job, going door to door to collect the gas company's money, I imagined Meterman as a worker bee. And a worker bee's job is to bring the money he collects back to the queen. So that's how the wife of the owner of Altamont Gas, Lady Altamont, came to be modeled after a queen bee. I also chose to design them as a pair so I could see them, I could set them apart from the other boldly colored and uniquely dressed characters in this game, and to create a sort of bee-themed uniform for the gas company. Altamont's umbrella is obviously her stinger. Other elements include her waist sash and Meterman's scarf, which were drawn to look like wings. Echt? Ja, doch, stimmt tatsächlich. Nice. His head in profile also somewhat resembles the shape of a bee in flight. Stimmt. Da wurde sogar noch ein Vergleichsbild dazu gemalt, wie das aussieht. Das ist cool. Ja, da steckt wirklich sehr viel Detail auch drin in den ganzen Designs. Das ist ziemlich nice. So, Gina Lestrade. When I first drew up her design, she was said to be a detective, yet she appeared in Adventures as a pickpocket. So really, Gina returning in this way was like her rising up into what she was always meant to be. For resolve, I brought back a portion of my original Inspector Lestrade design, whilst adding in bits of Gina's personality based on what had happened to her in the story so far. My main goal was to bring out more of a feminine side by giving her a cleaner and more stylish appearance. I also gave her a trench coat to make her more detective like and bring her closer visually to her mentor Gregson. Gina's horseback riding boots are a holdover from when I'd imagined her like a member of London's mounted police. I thought that perhaps she and Van Sieks could make an entrance together on horseback. The distinctive buttons on her hat are from the hat she used to wear as a pickpocket. Competitive as always, Gina's fashioned them into something resembling the goggles Sholmes and Iris wear, if in form only, on her new hats. Toby, now to the Hellhound, Chief Inspector Toby. Gina was always supposed to have a faithful canon companion, so when she was to return in Resolve, I pushed extra hard for her to finally have a dog this time around. And since there's already a detecting dog named Toby in the original canon, it was quickly approved. But when I looked into the Toby of the stories, I found that he wasn't as cute as I'd hoped, so I searched for an English breed that would pair well visually with Gina and made him a small, sweet puppy instead. Still, he has a proper police dog, so I gave him a tiny set of very sharp eyebrows. For the color of his fur, I wanted to give him the look and feel of a soft toy bear. Regarding the scarf around his neck, Gina's coat lining and scarf feature a traditionally British plaid design, so I thought to link the two of them together with it, as though they were cut from the same cloth. Wunderschön. Albert Hairbrain. When I first set out to design him during the first game's development, he was to be a brilliant teen scientist, so I gave him wild and unruly hair like Einstein's and glasses to make it easy to identify his personality. But Hairbrain's backstory was expanded upon in Resolve, and with him now being Van Sieks' best friend of a similar age, I had to rebalance his more outlandish animations and expressions. Update for Cuphead? Warum das denn? The fuck? To better fit the tone of their relationship, yay. From the beginning, Hairbrain was a bright and sunny character, and his huge range of expressions and boundless energy were crucial aspects of his personality, so I would shut down various faces and animations as I designed him. ODS man. On the surface, he's meant to look like just another nice rich man, yet there's something clearly suspicious about him as well. He doesn't appear in the game for long, but as he was to be in a few real-time cutscenes because he's the machine financier, we had to make a full-body 3D model of him. So I made sure to design him completely from head to toe, even though he mostly only shows up in illustrations. My favorite bit about him is his slightly annoyed and bored expression. As you can tell, I made Asman look as affluent as possible since his name in Japanese at the time was Richie Nande, a pun on why is he rich, but it was changed at the last second to Ryder Manningen, a pun on a great useless man. Had he always been Ryder Manningen, I think his design would have turned out very different indeed, which made me realize yet again just how important a character's name is to their design. Ayayay. Enoch Drabber. Story-wise, I was told he's an engineer with a black monocle whose hair color changes from black to white. So to make the transformation extra obvious, I turned the clear lens of his monocle black too, and loosened his neatly tied back hair into a messy sheet of white to clearly delineate his past self from his present. Him being an engineer gave me a chance to include some steampunk elements, and I wasn't about to miss it. The result is the mechanical gauntlet that doubles as a tool set on his left hand. The belts and the plus and minus buttons on his jacket are evocative of electrical cables and electrodes. I posited that we make Drabber's animation stiff and robotic, as if he became this way as a result of that traumatic night. After all, you have to wonder just how frightened he must have been for even his hair to turn completely white. It gives him something of a dark yet somehow likable feel, I think. Esmeralda Taspels. Originally, Taspels' name was simply Madame, and she was an elderly lady who was exceptional at her craft. But given the ratio of male to female characters, along with their ages and order of appearance throughout the game, I asked that she be aged down to a young lady instead. For story purposes, Taspels needed to wear a cape or something similar around her shoulders so that she could hide an arm underneath. She also needed to carry a bag or satchel. And because she was going to be featured in close detail during A Dance of Deduction, I really wanted to make her design as striking and memorable as possible. As a proprietor of an eerie waxworks museum, Taspels operates under the outrageous idea that she could create molds of her subjects from their very real bodies in order to make her soulless wax figures look alive. This conjured up images of black magic and alchemy, which led to me making her a witch. It might seem a little anachronistic, but I felt that the peculiar and mild disconnect would work well within a waxwork museum. Plus, only in the world of the Great Ace Attorney could I get away with expanding on the visual palette in this way, so I decided to go for it and gave her a completely witch-like appearance. Ja, ich finde, sie hat auch ein cooles Design, aber Drabber auch. Dr. Courtney Scythe. As a key figure in the story due to her standing as Scotland Yard's Chief Coroner, I treated her design as equal to that of a main character. I took extra care to balance her design with those of Strongheart, Von Siegs and other prosecutorial figures, given their relationship to one another and the mood during each of the encounters. I approached her design from the angle of men's attire, as I thought she would have been the exception to the rule back in the Victorian era, working in a very male-dominated field. To that base, I layered on a snake's motive, since snakes were a symbol of medicine at the time. Her syringes, oder so, are her fangs, and they lend her this cool and imitating aura like that of a venomous snake. The long, tightly curled piece of hair and the movable metal rods they are coiled around are also fashioned after snake fangs. Structurally, the rods are attached to the piece at the top of her head. The badge on her chest has a hearts and cross motive and was designed around the word Chief Coroner. As she is also the head of the forensic investigation team, I gave her a lot of sharp, straight lines evocative of Art Deco design to make her feel more modern. Mariah Gorry. Gorry is Scythe's daughter and a coroner in her own right. From the initial draft of the story, I'd gathered that Gorry was to be an eccentric young lady who loves to dissect things, so I tried to make her design unlike anything else in the game. The key is the imbalance between her cute, girly side and her dark side. Das ist auch gut getroffen, finde ich. While she shares a few common traits with her mother, she expresses her regular young girl side with a butterfly-themed butterfly-themed custom white coat and fancy ribbons. Her mask is a steampunk version of a plague mask, which I use to convey a sense of the past and the unique look of this game's world. Balthasar Loon. Because he's the impresario of sightseeing balloons at the Great Exhibition, I gave him a festive look that would fit right in with the carnival-like atmosphere and incorporated his balloons into his clothing. I knew that he would appear alongside gods in the game, so I added to his design toy balloons in the colors of his flying balloons, and gave him and gods a combined animation where he would hand one over to the boy. Bohemian Boy Gods. Gods is a child of the Bohemian royal family who came incognito to London to see the Great Exhibition. Mr. Takumi told me that there was a masked king of Bohemia who appeared in the original canon, and that he wanted Gods to be a homage to the character. For reference, he showed me an illustration from the short story of a dubious looking man with a large, thick mask on his face, and asked that I also incorporate that mask into my design. Since Gods is of the royal family of Bohemia, my first priority was to make it easily to tell he's a member of the nobility from a single glance. To that, I added elements from the man in the illustration to complete the homage. Finally, depending on how you look at him, I wanted there to be a sense that he had been dressed in that outfit like the privileged and entitled little boy he is. When creating his character model, we paid particular attention to the nuances of his facial structure and the translucent quality of his skin and cheeks that are typical of European children. It was also important to make the lines of his facial profile and shirt cuffs feel elegant and refined. Fabian de Rosso and Peppino de Rossi. These two are the ringleaders of the Red-Headed League, so first and foremost was making their red hair as conspicuous as possible. From there, I created their color schemes based on the flags of their respective countries of origin, France and Italy. Moment, was? Die color schemes sind... Stimmt. Lol, ist mir auch gar nicht aufgefallen, das ist ja krass. Der eine hat rot-weiß-grün wegen Italien und der andere hat rot-weiß-blau wegen Frankreich. Genau, da oben sind ja auch, jetzt sehe ich es gerade, sind auch die Flaggen abgebildet. Das ist cool. I especially like Peppino and his assorted expressions and animations. The pasta he slurps was inspired by Italy and his red hair, but the Shoryuken is there simply because we can. Ach, Shoryuken, genau. Wo er nach oben springt. okay, passt. Okay. Jetzt haben wir das letzte Drittel so ungefähr. Gossip Hugh Boone. According to Mr. Takumi, there's a story called The Man with the Twisted Lip in the canon. As Gossip's design was to pay homage to it, I sense great potential in the idea of the man who twisted his lip, as it were. Gossip acts the part of a buffoon in the story, so I made his overall design reminiscent of a circus clown. Venus. I was told she was a match seller, so I created a no-frills design for her. Sandwich. Das war schon über Venus? Okay. He was originally going to be a completely new character, but due to circumstances, I suggested that we merge him with Beppo from Adventures. I figured this could be his new job after he'd lost his old one of the over the Omnibus incident. And so, mixing elements of what was to be a new character with his old self, Beppo was reborn. Sort of. Daily and Evie Vigil. When I read the first draft of the story, I felt a strange sense of realism and charm in the marriage, and the distance between them. So I was a bit more restrained in how I expressed the personalities visually. Evie's pure love for her husband is evident in the way she genuinely worries about his disappearance and the actions she takes to find him. And knowing how much his wife loves him, Daily strives to keep her happy by hiding the ugly truth from her whilst leading a double life, until the very facts of his life themselves go into hiding within him. Daily looks tired all the time, but his eyes are full of warmth when he looks at Evie. That's the sense of sadness and sorrow I wanted to convey in his facial expressions. On the other hand, Evie's design shows how completely open she is and radiates a perpetually bright and happy aura like the sun. Barry Caden, from just the sound of his job, title of prison governor, a tall, stocky figure came to mind. From there, I built a few elements of dandyism into his design, taking him far away from the austere tastes of the stereotypical British gentleman. Other aspects of his look are based on a prison motive. The vertical stripes reminiscent of jail cell bars on both Caden and Vigil's waistcoats may be a point of pride for those in the prison service, I suppose. Caden also likes to talk with his back to people, so I really narrowed his waistline for a tight, sharp silhouette from behind and gave him rock-hard thighs and calves. There's a little bit of backstory to Caden that we didn't get to explore in the game, but as the prison's governor, he isn't well liked by the inmate population. One day, Caden was attacked in his office by a few escapees. That's when he got that scar on the back of his head. That's like cool. And ever since then, he's had that axe and rifle and a ton of handcuffs at the ready in his office for self-defense. He also carries a smaller axe in a holster by his side for that reason. We wanted to give him an animation using that smaller axe, but the fact that he has it on him at all is a quite testament, is a quite testament to the life he's lived. It's a vivid reminder that even when it's not depicted in the game, these characters have lived entire lives of their own. Das ist echt richtig cool, dass wir jetzt da noch mehr Lore erfahren haben, wo er seine Narbe her hat. Weil es mal, weil die ihn nicht alle mögen, die im Gefängnis sind, die Insassen. Kann ich auch verstehen, dass die ihn nicht mögen. und dann haben die ihn mal angegriffen und da hat er dann die Narbe bekommen. Ziemlich cool. Chicken Stroganoff. Chicken is Biff's little twin brother, so I hope you'll have fun looking for the similarities and differences in their designs. To bring out a sense of individuality, I used a little lick of hair in front to suggest that just maybe he might be slightly more naive than his older twin. I also made Chicken's colors different from Biff's, and at the same time changed the coloring of a certain sister ship to match, making it a bit more chic, for its role as the stage of a more spectacular show. May Strongheart. Taking his rightful place in the story, the Lord Chief Justice's return and resolve meant that I could finally draw him fully as I envisioned in my very first designs. Pulling those in his circle of influence under one by one, he is the embodiment of his name, the heart of the Maelstrom. His role in the story is also the reason why his other motive is the Unicorn, a highly intelligent creature that shares the royal coat of arms of the United Kingdom with a lion whilst possessing a deadly strength of its own. Strongheart's usual cane is replaced and resolve with a new unicorn hammer that makes a loud and unique clanging sound when used in court. It symbolizes the Lord Chief Justice himself in the final chapter of the story and adds a certain color the last trial to the last trial of the Great Ace Attorney. Das ist doof, weil ich kann einerseits nicht lesen, weil ich komplett fertig bin und wenn dann manchmal auch noch Rechtschreibfehler kommen, dann check ich gar nichts mehr. Und vielleicht waren da auch keine und ich war nur blöd. Kann auch sein, egal. Decent and breakdown. As the story unfolds, the tidy vortex in Strongheart's hair starts to spiral out of control until the little unicorn horn in it moves so out of place that the overall shape of his hair transforms into a raging inferno. As a reflection of his anger, his usually... Also, das war noch der Satz. Ja, reflection of his anger. His usually cool and intellectual demeanor also morphs into one of a terrifying ferocity. Then, during and after his breakdown, I wanted to capture him going out in an enormous blaze with nothing left to burn. It's a rather flashy breakdown, but one well suited to the end of his story, I think. Finde ich auch. I hope you take a look at the sequence again with my remarks in mind. Ja, der Breakdown von Strongheart ist ziemlich cool. Come to think of it, the backlit Strongheart with his arms stretched out towards the heavens in the key visual for Resolve is meant to make him look like he's been crowned with glory, but it's actually also a reference to his final scenes. Oh, wie süß. Iris' Lucky Charms. From the popular pairing of rabbit and bear characters in Japan, I had designed a set of handmade charms called Hairly and Bearis for Iris to carry around in her knapsack. And there they hung during all of adventures, waiting for their chance to shine until finally in Resolve, their day had come. Their inclusion in the story was just one of the requests I'd made of Mr. Takumi before we started work on Resolve. Besides Sholmes and Iris, I also created figures for the other main characters. I approached the designs from Iris' point of view, and it seems as though she rather thinks of Ryonosuke as just a bit mousy. Das sind übrigens auch noch die anderen. Von Sieg ist ja auch süß. Wunderschön. As for herself, it appears that while she's all pink and oh so cute on the outside, she fancies she's a real bear on the inside. In a bonus episode, I offered up the idea of including a Van Sieg's version, which produced Meow Sieg's, and the latest addition to the cast is Het Ina, oder so, who was used on some merchandise. I feel blessed that I was able to create a Lucky Charm design for each of the main characters. Herli, Beris, Shrunosuke, Lopsato, Klonsuma, The Mask, Apprentice, Meow Sieg's and Hachina. Yuru-Chara mascots, oder so. I initially doodled Yuru-Nosuke as a bit of fun during a break from my work. So here instead are my proper drawings from when we officially turned them into little piggy banks and giant stuffed toys. The retro chubby baby look is a throwback to a popular style of Japanese piggy banks from the late 20th century. So far there have been piggy banks of Yuru-Nosuke, Yuruma, Yums and Yuru-Sieg's. But what of the ladies, you may ask? I guess we just have to wait and see. So, bin ich durch? 23 waren es noch nicht. Ich dachte 27. Okay. Sehr gut. So. The Great Ace Attorney Adventures. Key visual. I work to capture the themes, atmosphere, and a general sense of the world itself in one illustration that embodies the whole of the first game with this piece. It's split roughly into two sections, with images of Britain dominating the upper half, whilst Japan takes the lead in the lower. From the fully drawn blade, a great wave arises, lifting sakura petals up into the English roses above. In this way, I've created a natural line for the eyes to follow that also conveys the trajectory of the story as it starts in Japan and shifts to Great Britain. Wie viele Gedanken da drin stecken. Ist krass. Ryunosuke's face hints at his iron will hidden deep within, while Susato shows a slight unease. The expression suggests how the story of their adventures overseas ultimately comes to a close. The Great Ace Attorney 2 Resolve Key Visual. Adventures was the first title in the Ace Attorney series to diverge so greatly from the mainline games in its setting that the key visual for it focused heavily on conveying the period, locals, and the general atmosphere of the world itself. However, with Resolve, it was time to move away from the setting, so the composition of this visual work works to emphasize the dramatic tale that binds these characters to one another. Ryunosuke stands at the center, with a look of strong resolve in his eyes, while Susato stands next to him with a wrapped around her shoulders. It's as though even after they were forced apart, fate has brought them back together. The top center represents a different time and shimmers with the golden light of a bygone era. From there, the light quickly fades into the dark shades of twilight and the mood shifts along with the colors to reflect the relationships between the destinies of each character present. Cherry blossoms, which are often used as a symbol of Japan, swirl around them like an embrace of a strong or a strong gust of wind. The ephemeral nature of sakura is layered atop a metaphor that the petals that had fallen to the ground in adventures will be swept up in the air again in resolve by this gust of wind, or perhaps headwind in Ryunosuke's case. All in all, I've painted a lot of meaning into this illustration, from each character's placement to the overall composition and colors, for you to discover once you finish the game, so who knows, perhaps you might even find something new. I also meant for this to be a companion piece to the key visual for adventure, so I'd make my day if you were to let your imagination run wild as you view the two pieces side by side. Ja, also die sind wirklich richtig cool. Und wie gesagt, was wir auch da gerade gehört haben, was der sich da alles überlegt hat, Kazuya, Nuri oder wie er heißt, für die Bilder, ist ziemlich krass. Nice. So, zwei Stück. Mit gar nicht so vielen Texten. Yay! The Great Ace Attorney Chronicles Key Visual. I aim to distill the essence of both Adventures and Resolve and blend them into a single piece that shows both the world and the story of the Great Ace Attorney with this. Additionally, now that both halves of the tale has been told and with the passage of time, I was also able to draw characters as I truly see them in this moment. As with my other key visuals, I put all my heart into capturing a lot of different things in this one composite picture. A single illustration that evokes the game's world and story, whilst bringing out the charm of each character. Because were I to draw each element separately, I should think I need something akin to a long picture. Scroll just to link them all together. And really, at the end of the day, I simply wanted to draw a beautiful picture. I sincerely hope that these key visuals can serve as your motivation to keep on playing and maybe even as the key to unlocking some fond memories of the game once you're through. Nothing would please me more than if my art could inspire you to lose yourself in the idyllic world of the Great Ace Attorney. Ein wahrer Poet. Sehr cool. Sehr, sehr cool. Das schauen wir uns auch nochmal. Ne, halt. So, komplett an. Mhm. Ja, ziemlich cool. So, ein letztes Bild haben wir noch. Thank you for playing. I'm closing. I'm personally fascinated with designs and illustrations where I can catch little glimpses of the thinking behind its form and details. So it's been an absolute joy for me to share even a sliver of my thought process here with you. Thank you so much for reading to the very end. Art director and character designer Kazuya Nuri. Ich hab zu danken. Yay, thank you for playing. Wunderschön. So, das war richtig cool. Ich habe nur nicht erwartet, dass es so viel sein würde. Ich hätte es doch in zwei Parts oder vielleicht aufsplitten sollen. Aber jetzt ist schon zu spät. Dann machen wir halt einen ewig langen Part. Meine Stimme braucht auf jeden Fall eine Pause. Aber die Porträts hier waren richtig cool. Gut. Und dann würde ich erstmal sagen, war es hier für diesen Part von Let's Play The Great Ace Attorney Chronicles. Beim nächsten Mal wird es dann noch weitergehen mit den Moving Pictures, die haben wir auch noch. Da gibt es eben noch Filme, die wir uns anschauen können. Aber das sind nicht einfach Cutscenes aus dem Spiel, das sind neue Filme. Hier The Great Special Trial. Dann das hier. Und dann haben wir hier noch Seven Days of Sin, was anscheinend nochmal eine Art Fall ist oder so. Ich weiß es nicht. Aber halt ohne Entscheidungen, nur Filmszenen. Aber trotzdem anscheinend nochmal eine große Geschichte, die wir uns da in diesen Filmszenen anschauen können. Und halt vor allem auch das hier, was das soll, da bin ich auch sehr gespannt. Und das werden wir uns dann eben beim nächsten Mal angucken. Gut. Also dann, Leute, bis zum nächsten Mal. Ciao.